Very dear ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome you on this exhibition called Fleeted, about fragrances, flavors, smells we're not used to any longer. Normally we would have loved to meet with you in a different environment, but now we do it like this. Anyway, whenever it's possible again, please visit the Mauritshuis and come and please watch all those paintings, but also smell the paintings, because that's really very special about this exhibition. For the first time, you can watch 17th century paintings and at the same time smell the fragrances and odors and parfums from that period. Smells we're not used to anymore. So it's quite innovative. I hope you will enjoy it, and I also hope you will enjoy the tour by Ariane van Zuchtelen, the curator of this exhibition. And perhaps we meet another time in life. Bye-bye.
Welcome to the exhibition Fleeting Sense in Color in the Mauritshuis. This is an exhibition about smells and about the depiction of smells in art. What are the meanings of smells? What associations do they have for us as viewers of art? And what different questions can be asked about the depiction of smell and about how we view works of art? There are enormous amounts of smells around us that and work directly on our emotions. So it's a straight connection to the emotional part in our brain, which makes smell such an important sense for us, and which is so much related about to how we view art. So this exhibition raises a lot of questions about viewing art, about how we use all of our senses to look at art, and how our sense of smell can help us to enhance, as it were, the experience of looking at art. So it's a wide range of subjects in this exhibition, which begins with this very special self-portrait by a painter from Utrecht called Johannes Wijkersloot. And in fact, it is a sort of praise of painting in a sense, but he tells us how the painter refers to all of our senses to look at art, and how he, as an artist with his paint, can depict everything, even something as invisible as smell. What you see here is a man depicted on the hand drum on the right, who pinches his nose to protect himself from the stench that comes up here from the burning rope. From one pictorial space to the other, the smell is able to go everywhere, and the painter, and that's most important, is able to depict everything, even smell, and can also suggest everything in his art. Then the exhibition goes on to the senses. We view the world, of course, with all of our five senses: sight, hearing, smell, touch, and taste. And that has been, since a long time, a traditional subject in art. In the late 16th century, the subject of the five senses becomes very popular in printmaking. And then in the 17th century, it also becomes a subject in paintings. And we have a selection of prints, but also a few paintings that depict the senses, but also the sense of smell, of course, in particular. It begins with a depiction of the senses as female personifications. And each of those females is accompanied by an attribute, an animal. And in the case of smell, that attribute is a dog, who is, of course, known for his keen sense of smell. Here you see a number of five prints by Hendrik Goltzius, where the senses are portrayed as couples, as couples that are in love, because the senses traditionally have everything to do with the sensual world of love. And the sense of smell you see in the upper right is depicted by this woman holding up the rose, the sweet smelling rose in between her nose and the nose of her lover. And the dog is patted on the head here in the foreground. The senses and love is also very much a subject in this painting by David Finkbones of the early 17th century. It's really a feast of sensual pleasure, you could say. It's a lovely garden scene depicted in spring. All flowers are in bloom. And in the foreground, there are five couples, and each of them depicts one of the senses. They're playing, there's enough food, there's drink, there's music, the love is in the air, and it's a wonderful festive scene. The sense of smell is depicted by this couple behind the table in which the man picks a rose that he hands to his lover, and she has a small pet dog on her arm. So it's all got to do with love and the senses. In the inscriptions on prints, you can add an extra layer of meaning. And in those, you read very often about the dangers of sensual pleasures and pleasure and how sin can enter the human mind, the human heart, through the senses. So it's very important to be careful about the senses. But you can't really tell that by looking at the scenes. In the course of the 17th century, the senses are depicted either by very elegantly dressed burghers, but there's later tradition that becomes much more closely connected to daily life. And there's also a tradition of having the senses depicted by boorish types, you know, sort of country folk ridiculed very much in those scenes. For instance, in those five scenes by Haarlem painter Jan Mienze Molenaar, country folk drinking, boorish types, and the sense of smell is depicted by the bottom being wiped of this baby in the foreground, a huge stench sort of put under our noses, and this man sort of backs off in horror, smelling this awful smell here. The sense of smell is also often connected to smoking, as you see in this depiction of a ridiculed man depicting smell, smoking his pipe. There's numerous subjects, numerous examples in printmaking. Another subject, which is of course important when you think about smell and art, are flower still lifes that become hugely popular in the 17th century. Before it wasn't a subject in Dutch art, but he always wonders, flowers are not just beautiful in colors and in the shapes, but also, of course, in real life have a lovely smell. And were those artists aware of that effect in their paintings? Did they want to have that suggestion of smell in their paintings? It's not always easy to tell, but sometimes it is. In this painting, it seems quite clear that there is a very strong suggestion of smell. It's not just the blooming flowers in a landscape, not in a vase, but there are also fruits in this painting, very ripe, overripe fruit, which causes this very strong suggestion of smell. For instance, the melon on the right foreground, which is so ripe that it's almost opened up, and lots of small ants and animals were attracted to that smell. And also there's rotting plumes over there. It has a very strong suggestion of overripe fruit that is also connected, of course, to the blooming flowers. So in this case, the suggestion of smell seems to be really intentional. In daily life, we are surrounded by thousands of smells. And of course, that was the same in the 17th century. But a lot of those smells are lost. We don't know them anymore. What did you smell in the 17th century? And what can we see or find in works of art that refer to smells from the past? So what did you smell inside of your house, and what did you smell when you stepped out of your house? In this painting by Pieter de Hoogh, it's a beautiful scene of typically Dutch, a canal house, very clean, and the two women are together in front of the linen cupboard and take out the laundered linen from there. It is a very lovely suggestion of smell of fresh linen that you have in this painting. But when you look through the door, you can already see the canal outside of the house. The house is outside. And those canals were famous for their terrible stench. In this painting by Jan van der Heijden, an Amsterdam cityscape, where you see the old church of the city here, a very detailed and a lovely depiction of an Amsterdam scene. And when you look more closely into the details of this painting, you can also see references to smells of the time. And what is very interesting is this detail of a wooden structure next to the bridge over the canal, which is in fact a privy, and a privy directly onto the stinking canal. So it's a public toilet. Next to it is a man sweeping up the horse manure. And when you look closely, you see a lady here, a woman, doing her laundry in that dirty water of the Amsterdam Canal. So there's, for viewers in the 17th century, the suggestion of smell, the associations they would have had with looking at a painting like this would be quite different from how we look at it today, when the canals no longer smell so badly in Dutch towns. It's a very interesting contrast between those very nice ladies in front of the linen cupboard in a clean, beautiful house, and this poor woman who has had to do her laundry in the stinking canal. We have reconstructed two smells here for those paintings. One is you can smell from this here, from here, the dry molecules of the smell. In this case, it's a reconstructed perfume of what's sweet bags that were put into linen cupboards. And here we have reconstructed the smell of Dutch canals, which is a terrible mix of manure, of rotten vegetables, of privies and sewers, of rotten fish, everything put together, which caused that terrible stench of the water. One is this lovely view of the city of Haarlem by Jacob van Ruisdael. You can see the profile of the city against the sky. And in the foreground, you see the bleaching fields outside of Haarlem, where the linen was bleached in the sun. It was, in fact, a chemical process that was quite smell intensive, using lactic acid, all used to bleach the linen. For us, that smell has disappeared from the countryside with the bleaching fields. And we recreated that smell, and the visitor can smell it here. And while looking at this lovely painting by Ruisdael, the visitor can at the same time smell that very particular odor from the past. Also, quite a number of odors from the Dutch countryside have disappeared forever. Now, and one of them is the smell of lime kilns. There were a huge number of those along the Dutch waterways, and that's where seashells are burnt, causing a huge stench in order to produce mortar for the building industry. And another one, which is very interesting, is the smell of the gallows. Each Dutch town would have a gallows outside of the city walls where the executed criminals were put to rot. And the stench must have been a terrible warning for the people walking by and smelling that smell, which in fact is the one smell that everybody which is worldwide, feels repulsion, a very strong sense of repulsion for. Smell and health is a subject in the exhibition. Smells could be the cause of fear. There was quite a different idea about what smells could do to a human body. They could actually, it was thought that diseases like the plague were transmitted through the air, and that the human skin was in fact porous, so that the disease could enter the body directly. So it was quite important to protect yourself against particular smells, particularly the smell of rotting material, the smell of a human corpse in this case. It's an anatomy lesson that we see here, painted by father and son van Mierenveld. And we see the body, the abdominal part, has just been opened by the doctor, giving this lesson, anatomy lesson, to the surgeons surrounding him. And they all protect themselves against the smell. There's a burning candle here, there's incense burning, they have different herbs holding here in their hands. And there was one man who holds a pomander in his hand, which is actually a scent ball, in this case a silver one, filled with a perfume. He can hold it to his nose and he can protect himself with the pomander against that that smell of the corpse. Pomanders were for women hugely fashionable, and you see this lady wearing her beautiful pomander on the gold chain around her waist. The word pomander comes from the French pomme d'ambre, which means apple of amber, which refers to ambergris as an important ingredient, like you see this lady here wearing her pomander from that three double chain around her waist. Filled with the perfume, she could at each moment lift her pomander towards her nose, and the perfume would work not only as deodorant, but also, very important, as protection against smells that could spread diseases, especially the plague, which was a real danger and real fear still in the 17th century, where there were quite a few epidemics of the plague still. Here we have a number of silver pomanders. Two of them are quite interesting because they have the shape of an orange, more or less, with outfolding compartments. And they could be filled with different ingredients. And on one of them, engraved in the silver, is an inscription of what ingredient could be put into that that section. For instance, ambergris or musk or civet. Those three are animal ingredients of perfumes, which were much heavier at that time than they are today, but also lighter ingredients from flowers or herbs like lavender or rose, for instance. We reconstructed the perfume of the winter pomander. You can smell now. And it has a number of ingredients, quite a few actually. The animal ingredients, civet, musk and ambergris, but also different other ones, raisins, lavender, cloves, different spices, all put together in this smell used in the 17th century. It's a beautiful depiction, this print, of a historic event. It took place in December of 1601. A sperm whale landed on the beach near Beverwijk in Holland. Huge numbers of people flocked together to look at that incredible sea monster. This man is protecting himself from the smell of that rotting animal with a handkerchief towards his nose. And what is important about sperm whales is that in their intestines, ambergris can be found. And ambergris is a sort of sticky fat substance which is formed in the intestines of sperm whales to protect the intestines from sharp remains of squid. It's a very costly ingredient for perfumes, still used today, although today more synthetic ambergris is used. In the Dutch Republic had increasingly easy access to all the products from far off lands, thanks to the overseas trade that flourished in the 17th century. New spices became more and more common, like a nutmeg, cloves, all of those spices, cinnamon, from pepper from the east, but also tobacco, coffee and tea. Tobacco became really popular in the 17th century, and it also enters art. And smoking is very much connected to drinking of alcohol. For instance, in this scene by Adriaan Brouwer, you can see this smoker enjoying the smell, the wonderful odor of the tobacco that he blows out of his mouth here in this painting. This beautiful silver ship is actually a spice holder. It symbolizes so much the wealth and the promise of what the overseas trade brought to the Dutch Republic. It has the shape and also the arms, the coat of arms, of one of the ships who returned from Asia in 1600, full of spices, successfully for the first time. So it really refers to that new trade route to the east. And underneath the top of the ship, there are compartments where different spices like nutmeg, cloves or mace, pepper could be put. So put in the middle of the table, it very much symbolizes all of that luxury that became common in the 17th century. Of course, in those works of art, beautiful as they are, we don't see anything of the dark side of that trade, the exploitation, the oppression, the violence that was also, of course, the other side of the coin of that trade to the east. Next to it is a painting by Willem van Mieris, which is a grocer's shop. It dates from the early 18th century. And on the shelves in the shop, you see there are a number of boxes. What is in the boxes is written on them, like nutmeg, like cloves. And it represents how at the end of the 17th century, beginning of the 18th century, all of those spices, all of those products have become completely common and reachable for a large number of people in the Netherlands. Here we have, for the visitor to smell, the smell of a combination of those spices. You can smell here. It enhances very much the experience. And of course, smell has the ability to bring you back through your memory into early childhood. And we all have that experience that a whiff of something can bring you back to a long time ago. And that happens, to me at least, that happened also while smelling this grocer's shop. Smell and religion are very much connected to each other. In many faiths, smells play an important role in different rituals. And that is, of course, very much the case also in the Catholic faith. Two paintings here represent that. One is a Catholic, very Catholic still life, and the other is a Protestant church interior. In the scene here on the left, there's a beautiful silver censer, different symbols that refer to the Virgin Mary that have very strong scents, like incense, like rosemary, which has her name in its name, of course, which is also known for its strong smell, and a blooming rose. And next to it is the interior of the Bavo Church in Haarlem. The Protestant reformers waged war against all the rituals of the Catholic faith and sort of banned all smells and other things from the churches, and only had the word of God became prominent in the Protestant service. You see a depiction of a Protestant service in formerly Catholic church, which is now whitewashed, and all of those things that refer to that, the old rituals, are banned from the church. And in the foreground, which is an interesting detail, is a half-opened grave. Of course, during the plague, well, at the time that, which happened quite often still in the 17th century, people were very much afraid of the smell of rot, of corpses. And there were actually rules that during services in the church, the graves in the church where people were buried a lot, of course, during the plague, had to be covered up to protect the churchgoers. In the last part of the exhibition, there's a number of history paintings, and those are scenes that are based on literary sources like the Bible, but also mythological sources. And depicted are stories in which a smell plays a role in the narrative. And there's quite a few stories to be told. For instance, the raising of Lazarus, which is a miracle that Christ performed, very striking painting by Jan Lievens. You see Christ looking up to the Lord, and in the tomb, it's you see, if you look closely, the two white hands of Lazarus being raised. And it's all about the sister Martha of Lazarus. She's depicted here. She is struck by fear and she tells Jesus, "Oh, Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. He's going to smell." But of course, she has to learn to believe in the divine miracle. Next to it is a painting by Pieter de Gebber, the Adoration of the Magi. They bring gifts to the newborn Christ child. And two of those gifts are scents, are smells. Incense, of course, that you see here in the censer, but also myrrh, that you can smell here as a visitor, because myrrh is a smell that hardly anybody knows. It's a very bitter smell, and in that sense it is symbolic, because it refers to the suffering of Christ in the future, his passion, his death on the cross for the salvation of mankind. Stories in which a body smell play an important role. It's the blessing of Jacob by Isaac. Isaac is blind, he's the old father, it's a scene from the Old Testament. He wants to bless his oldest, his firstborn son, but he's being tricked because the younger son, with the help of his mother, has put on the clothing of his older brother. So Isaac smells his son and gives him his blessing to the wrong child. And another one has to do a lovely scene of a story which takes place during the First Crusade to Jerusalem. It's about the Christian hero Rinaldo. He's being chased by the witch Armida. With her tricks, she makes him fall asleep. She comes out of her hiding. She wants to kill him. But then when she sees him and she smells him, he smells this wonderful smell. Her hate turns into love and she falls in love and, of course, doesn't kill him any longer. So that's a story very much having to do with smell and love. And, of course, a smell has a very important social function in all of our lives, where we choose our lovers, for instance, by their smell, partly. If a lover doesn't smell nice, it's without hope. Well, thank you very much for your attention. We really hope that you'll be able to visit us soon, that we can open our doors for the public and that people can come and enjoy the beautiful artworks in this exhibition, but also smell all the smells that accompany the works of art. Thank you.
Very warm welcome to this international press conference in the Maatshuis for our exhibition Fleeting Scents in Color. We're very welcome that you're all attending us from all over the world, United States, France, Germany, the UK. We are very thankful to the NBTC, the Netherlands Bureau of Tourism and Conventions, and to IFF, International Flavors and Fragrances, for working with us for this press conference. And of course, right now, it's an unusual press conference online. We're not yet open due to the COVID situation in here in the Netherlands, but hopefully we'll be able to open very soon. Maybe not all of you have visited the Maurithuis before. We're a museum in the center of The Hague, not far from Amsterdam, about 45 kilometers. And we're located in a beautiful 17th century, we've just seen it in the film, palace in the city, next to the government center of the Netherlands. And we have a collection of mainly 17th century Dutch and Flemish paintings. So we have old masters like Rembrandt, Johannes Vermeer, Frans Hals, Jan Steen in our collection. And maybe our famous painting is The Girl with the Pearl Earring by Vermeer. So hopefully you'll be able to come soon and visit our exhibition. And I'll be very happy to answer questions now about our exhibition that my colleague will ask me now that you've put on online.
Thank you, Ariane. Good evening, bonsoir, guten Abend. This is Boris Demunik from the press office. I have some questions, Ariane. The first one is, what did the linen fields actually smell like? And one of the journalists said it smelled like lactic acid. But now the question is, how does lactic acid smell, Ariane?
Well, that's one of the smells that we have reconstructed for this exhibition that we are showing, or that we are offering to our visitors with the painting by Jacob van Ruisdael. You've seen in the film the view of Haarlem with the bleaching fields in the foreground. That smell was very particular and, of course, has disappeared from the countryside with the bleaching fields that are no longer there. They were so thought to be so beautiful that they were really a tourist attraction even at the time. But the smell must have been quite peculiar, quite strong. And it's a combination of a sort of lactic elements, acids, cobalt to blue the linen. It's a process a chemical process that lasted a number of weeks to actually bleach the linen in the field. So it has a touch of grass in that smell as well. And it's one of the historical smells that have disappeared and that we have reconstructed for this exhibition. And hopefully when you smell and look at the same time, that enhances your experience.
Thank you. Second question. How long did it take to put together all these paintings with a connection to smell and scent, Ariane?
Well, we started organizing this exhibition, I think, about 2.5 years ago. And it was a bit of a journey to look at things and to try to think through the idea of this exhibition. It begins with art historical subject, all the allegories of smell, and it ends with art history, with the history paintings that end the exhibition. And in between, of course, there's thousands of stories to be told about smell, and there are thousands, really thousands of smells that exist. But we had to choose and had to be connected to the art. And the Mauritshuis is focused, or the specialty of the Mauritshuis is the Dutch 17th century. And so if a smell is not depicted in a work of art, or if there's nothing that could be found, it would not be included in the exhibition. So it's in that sense, it's limited. But on the other hand, it raises questions about that are much broader than just the works of art. It's about viewing, about using the senses and how that works, and how all of your senses and your emotions work together to experience art. So it took a while. It was and we left out a number of things, included a number of things, so ended up with this exhibition.
Our next question, a nice one. How do you establish what a bleaching field might have smelled like?
We know from the sources, the historical sources, what the procedure was, the chemical procedure for bleaching linen. So we worked together with IFF, who made the smells for our exhibition. And so their perfumers were told by us that it has to be the number of ingredients, the lactic acid, you know, a touch of grass, you know, different things. And that's how they managed to recreate that smell in particular, and other smells as well.
Another good question. Is the exhibition in any way virtual for members of the public?
Any way what?
Is it in any way virtual for the public? Yes, it will be.
You mean real for the public?
No. Virtual. So
what's
we will
virtual?
Have the virtual so that the public can see the exhibition. You can tell about our new exciting story.
Online, you mean?
Online, yes.
Oh,
sorry.
I see.
Online.
Sorry, online. I didn't quite get that question. Yes, that's the idea. We've, of course, in this COVID period, we're much more focused on anything online. And we've gone really quickly with that. So as long as we're not yet open, we really hope that it won't be much longer than a few weeks. But also during the entire period of the exhibition, which is, by the way, extended till the end of August, the 29th of August, we will also offer online tours. So what we do is we develop another box. You had this luxury box with two smells, but we have another type of box with four smells of the exhibition, and we have a filmed tour. So that will be an online tour of the exhibition, of the art of the exhibition. So we do try to involve our public in an online way.
Can people who are interested, can they already let their interest be known, Ariane?
Certainly. On our website, which Boris will type in the chat part of this session, you can leave your name and we'll let you know when this kit, this online tour with the different smells will be ready. We're really working on it right now. It will also have the same sort of smell pumps. And we expect to have that in March.
Thank you. Next question. Can you please tell us more about how you planned and executed the scent dispenser system inside the exhibition galleries? Did you work with a specialist consultant or IFF? Indeed, it was IFF, but can you maybe dwell a little bit on that?
Yes, absolutely. Well, of course, we're in the middle of this pandemic, so we had to make something which was without risk for the visitors. So that's why we chose for those foot pumps, so you don't have to touch anything. And the smells are dispensed within that piece of furniture. There's a bottle with the oil, with the smell, and the foot pumps lets out a number of molecules of that particular scent. So the scent, what we didn't want in the exhibition was all scents, all smells to be one big stench in, you know, entering the entire space. So we really wanted to stay local. And that's why this system that we would develop with IFF and Karel Verbeek, who is a smell specialist, works really well, because it's really local. You smell your nose a little bit above the funnel, the smell comes up, just a few molecules, and that's it. So it's a very sophisticated system, and it's completely corona-proof, we call it.
Many questions pouring in, so nice questions too. How many paintings and artworks are in the museum's collection? So not in the collection of the exhibition, but in the museum's collection. Are there also paintings on loan from other places? I think that is about the exhibition.
Yes, in the exhibition it's certainly a loan exhibition, although there's quite a few paintings from our own collection. We have 15 from our own collection, and all the other works are loans. The Maashuis itself is a museum of only Old Master paintings, and we have 800. We have 350 here in our the main works in our palace in the city, and we have a second building just 400 yards from here, where other works are displayed in a way that's the beginning of the collection in the 18th century. So they're displayed in different layers, full of paintings in that part, which is sort of recreated 18th century paintings gallery.
Barbara Palmer asks, what was your personal experience in seeing the art with the addition of historical sense?
Yeah, that's a nice question, because it really, smelling and looking enhances your experience very much. And of course, we all have, we know that smells work really directly, as it was explained in the film, also on your emotional system. But all of us also have a sort of a smell memory, which is filled with thousands of smells. And if you smell, you have a whiff of something, most of us have the experience that can bring you back within an instant to early childhood, where you smell the house of your grandparents. So that works really in an emotional level, and has all to do with different memories that come back to the foreground by smell. So it has a very strong effect, very much on a subconscious level also, on us. And that works also with our sort of mental smelling agency. So if you see a painting, if somebody in the 17th century, a viewer, would see a scene of a canal, you know, it would have a different experience of it, because that in this smell, this person's smell memory, you know, the stench would come to the foreground and might find it repulsive. Where for us now, it doesn't have that connection anymore. So it's also very much a matter of who is smelling and when, and the background of a person.
Historical question, Ariana. When did bleaching fields cease to exist?
Well, I was surprised to find out actually that they continued to exist a long way into the 20th century. And we're actually in the 1950s, there was still maybe not, you know, the huge bleaching industry of Haarlem, for instance, which was a textile city, that had disappeared much earlier, but smaller bleaching fields were still there. And actually, we had a very elderly visitor once that made me think of the Jacob van Ruisdael, who we took on a tour through the museum. And in front of that painting, he was immediately struck by that painting. He said, oh, I remember that smell so clearly. It comes back to me right away looking at this painting. So that was maybe also a source of inspiration for this show.
Also an interesting question. You mentioned the smell in the city at the time. Were people more immune to the stink than we are today? And did people then find other smells pleasant than we find today?
Yeah, that's very possible. The smelling organ, our sense of smell works, is in such a way that we get used to smells within, let's say, 5-6 minutes, which is very much connected to the function of smells to warn us. So it's if you smell something, then after a few minutes it disappears, so there's space in your head, let's say, to smell danger again. So if you smell gas, for instance, if you still continue to smell a particular perfume and you can't smell gas, then you can't do something about the danger. So that's how smell works. What's the other part of your question?
Did people then find other smells pleasant than we find today?
Possibly, yes. We find that the perfumes, the recipes for perfumes, that also the ones that we reconstructed for this exhibition, are much stronger than perfumes of today. So you can imagine that of course, the deodorants didn't exist as we have them today. So they would need perhaps stronger perfumes to sort of mask the body odors, for instance. So yes, there were different fashions. And of course, like today, it's a matter of taste. You know, one person likes a perfume and the other person hates it. So it's also that, I suppose.
Question, to your knowledge, Ariane, has an exhibit involving smell like this ever been undertaken before?
Well, there have been different initiatives in historical museums and there was in contemporary art, but for instance, there's a museum in the UK, I think in York, with the Vikings, about the Vikings, so it's really connected to a particular theme. And there have been an exhibit for children having to do with smells in the Dutch 17th century, but it wasn't really an exhibition. So as far as I know, it's the first time that we really focused entirely in an exhibition on smells with old master paintings, old master works of art. So in that sense, I think it's new. There's other initiatives, smaller initiatives, of course, that you see in different historical museums, you would be offered smells. You know, that's not entirely new in a museum exhibit. But to have that as a focus, as a theme of an exhibition and go further into it, I think that is, as far as I know, was not done like this before.
Thank you. I don't think we have any more questions. Last call for questions. But of course, I already sent you press office@maritzhuis.nl. If you have any more requests or questions after this meeting, please contact me, Boris Demunik, in the press office, and I will forward, of course, your questions to Ariane. Thank you again, NBTC and IFF, and the last word, of course, is for the curator, Ariane van Zuchtelen.
Well, thank you so much for your attention. It's wonderful that you've been with us on this virtual tour of the exhibition, and that you I'm very happy that you'd be able to smell the two smells. I hope you enjoyed them, and really hope to be able to see you, that we can open our doors again for our visitors and see you here in person. Thanks so much.
My last word. A French question. Laurent-nous recevoir des visuels de l'expo? All the images of the exhibition you can see on mauritshuis.nl/press, but also if you have any extra requests for images, please contact press office@mauritshuis.nl. Oh, yes, last thing, yes, Ariane.
This is the catalogue that we did for the exhibition, almost forgot, it's in front of me, which is not a traditional catalogue, but has 10 different articles about looking at the subject from all different perspectives. So the sense, the stench in the cities, the personal hygiene, the working of the sense of smell, anything. So that's with the exhibition. Thank you.